Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. That's right. Well, I want to welcome you for the opportunity to worship and praise the Lord. And I just pray that each one would feel God's presence, knowing that we've all been made in the image of God. God desires to have a relationship with each one of us that is real, that is personal, and what a blessing that is. Are there any announcements? Are there any announcements today? Yes. Okay.
Good morning. Uh-oh, it's me. It's on. No? Is it? Can you hear me? Oh, there you go. Sorry. Probably with my mask. I don't know. Two announcements. Should I wait on Moments for Missions? Do I wait on that? I do.
Well, give us...
Well, real quick, Moments for Missions baskets, there's one up here over on this little table. There's one over here behind me on the bench, and there's a couple over here on the bench in the foyer. That's for Moments for Missions for this Sunday. But the other announcement is UMW, which is still UMW until the first of the year. And then at the first of the year, we've changed our name from UMW to the Ellsworth Methodist Women. And so, but we still will go by UMW for the rest of the year. And so our can out here says for soup supper. And we're just asking for whatever you would have spent on your donations towards soup supper, that if you feel like you can give a little bit, then that will go back in our budget because we're not having soup supper. So thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Deb. Are there any other announcements? Okay. I think we got a few.
Hello. I got a phone call from Mason May yesterday. He had back surgery on Thursday, and he's on Friday, I guess it was. And he's doing fine. He's up, said he's up, walking up and down the hallway, so everything was going good. He said he went in with a 8 or 9 pain, and the day I talked to him, he says, I'm down to a 2, and it's probably from the surgery, so... It was successful. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, Mason said, tell everyone thank you for the prayers and continually to pray for him, but he is doing better and he'll be home very, very soon. And
Today is Ken's birthday. Yay! He caught up with me. And also that this week we start Kids of the Kingdom. And it will be different, and it's going to be stepping out in faith. So we will see how it goes, and we just appreciate everyone's prayers. We'll only start with kindergarten and first grade here, and fourth grade will be at the Presbyterian Church. So we'll just kind of spread out and do what we can. But we really feel like God wants us to continue on spreading his word. So until we're told differently, we're going to keep on. So thanks. Yeah.
I just wanted to thank everybody for the prayers for our son-in-law Greg Gordon, Deb's husband, and of course he now got home last Monday week, but gaining each day, I think, and it's truly a miracle that he came through this, because it didn't look good for several days there. So we're thankful for that. Yesterday we got to see him. He was on the porch and we were in the street, but at least we got to see him, so that was neat too. And David talked to him on the phone once. And then after we got back to Ellsworth, we found out that Lou Adams is improving, and so we were very happy to hear that, because she'd really been a concern. And anybody with COVID, it's a dreaded disease, and so we all need to obviously be careful and do what we need to do to try to keep from getting it. And thank you again for the prayers.
We have a couple of joys. The girls here to my right, Stephanie and JC, finished second at regionals in tennis, so they will be going to state tennis next weekend. Okay. Thanks to Coach Maysog and Coach Anderson for everything they've done to help these girls out. Over the past 4 years they've been playing tennis, they've done an awesome job all 4 years. The other joy on Tuesday is Deanna's birthday, so wish her a happy birthday this week.
Okay. And congratulations, and And that's been 4 years in a row all the way through high school. And what a blessing that is. Wow. What accomplishment. And are there any other announcements? I look at our calendar on the back. I'm just going to lift up a few things, if you would. We have a Bible study at 6 here in the sanctuary. Tomorrow at 6:30, we'll have a finance stewardship meeting by Zoom. And on Tuesday, we'll have confirmation class. And there's been five confirmands and myself, and we're meeting in the office. And then at 6:30, they'll have the missions and evangelism meeting at Pines. And then Wednesday, as Alice said, we'll have Kids of the Kingdom, and that'll be K through first grade this Wednesday, and then fourth grade at the Presbyterian Church. Please keep that in your thoughts and prayers. We'll have a leadership executive meeting. It'll be in the sanctuary, all the leadership team, and just want to lift that up. That'll be at 6:30. This is how we're going to do, kind of get ready for charge conference. I got a hand up. Yes, Jason.
Oh, the other thing, the girls' tennis team, JC and Steph did play second, but the whole team came back home with a regional championship. So,
wow,
it was a pretty good day, good 2 days for the whole team. So,
okay, thank you, and we are so thankful and so proud of them. And wow, first place for the whole region. All right, the team did. And so, the leadership executive meeting is how we're going to handle charge conference. It gets all the paperwork done or things voted so they can do a webinar. And that's why we'll be doing that Wednesday at 6:30. And then you can see the other things that are on next Sunday also, like United Methodist Men's Breakfast and those kind of things. But anyway, did want to kind of direct your attention to the back of the bulletin. Are there anything else? If not, I'll step out so we can center ourselves. And I'm going to ask you to bow your hands, bow your heads, open up your hands and your hearts and minds, and let us go to God. Morning, Lord. We thank you and praise you for this day, for the opportunity to worship you and praise you and just draw near to you. Because you are all so worthy. But I have to admit, dear Lord, even though I say it, there's many times I may not focus on you. There's times I'm holding on to things that I need to do, things that I left done, or just anxiety or brokenness, and my focus isn't on you. And dear Lord, none of us were meant to carry it. 700 times in your word you tell us to come to you. So I pray today that we would allow you to work in our lives, that the Holy Spirit would loosen the grips of the things we're so tightly holding on to, that we would truly surrender it and lay it at the foot of the cross. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one that is unlimited. Now we have empty, open hands, receive the blessings that you have for each one of us. We have empty, open hands. Receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness. And gracious God, you have chosen to use us to make a difference wherever we are, that others can receive that love. They can receive that forgiveness, that grace, that mercy that we have received from you that we can give to them. I also pray if there's anyone that needs a special touch today, they'd feel your presence. Dear Lord, that they know that you are there, that you love them, that you have forgiven them, and you'll never leave us nor forsake us, that we can count on you. We thank you and praise you in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people say,
amen.
Now at this time, we'll have a call to worship.
Please join me in the call to worship with Psalm 62, 5 through 8. Yes, my soul, find rest in God.
My hope comes from you. Truly, my rock and my salvation.
My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge.
Trust in Him at all times, pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge.
Gracious God, you are a refuge. You are our salvation. You are our redeemer. And dear Lord, you tell us to come to you, to bring our prayers to you, our prayers, our petitions, our intercessory, with thanksgiving. So gracious God, we thank you for all the joys that were lifted up, for birthdays, for the starting of Kids of the Kingdom, for victories of winning regionals as a team, for girls that represent our church, dear Lord, for also for them going on to state. We thank you for all these things. We thank you for how well Mason is doing and what a blessing that is. He was telling me, he said, tell everyone thank you for the prayers. They're working. I feel better. He was in a lot less pain, and I just thank you for that and give you the glory. I thank you how much better Lou is doing. When I talked to her nurse yesterday, the nurse said that it was a good day and her oxygen levels were better, that she might be able to go on the floor. She may already be on the regular floor now. Dear Lord, they said it could happen in 5 minutes or it could happen within the next day. But we thank you and praise you. I know there will also be a celebration of her brother's service in Sylvan Grove today at 2 at the football field, and minister to each and every heart there. We thank you as Greg is doing better, as Nancy shared, and what a blessing that is. Dear Lord, there are many that are hurting. There are many that are weak. Minister to them. And we lift up Donna Wooten, dear Lord, and continue to minister to her as she is in hospice care at her hospital. We thank you again for loving us, for caring for us, for ministering to us. Dear Lord, you have forgiven us. Dear Jesus, you have paid the price for our sins. And dear Lord, we thank you again for that salvation. And all we have to do is receive it. Just ask you to come into our hearts to forgive us, and as we repent and admit that we are sinners, as we confess, and we ask that you come in and dwell in our hearts to be our Lord and Savior. We thank you for this. Now, gracious God, we come before you today in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. And as we say this prayer, I ask for the leading of the Holy Spirit. I ask also just to remind us and that we would live out each of these words by the Spirit as we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give to us this day daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Amen. Now at this time, we'll have the hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be, and you'll find that on hymn number 399. If you're comfortable standing, you may stand, and it's also on the screen.
Thank you.
may be seated. And in the bulletin, it talks about the moment of mission. It's for our daily bread, the devotion and that we have out there in the foyer. And that's such a blessing. And as Deb said, there's baskets put out. And at this time, we'll have a moments for mission. But as the children come, not moment for mission, but as the children come forward for children's time, I want to lift up Janice Black, as she had a procedure and she's doing well. I just remembered her when I was looked out and didn't see her face, but she is doing well and recovering, and we praise God for that. Well, I've been talking about giving. This has been our stewardship campaign, and we have Consecration Sunday. But I want to show you something. You know what this is? Yeah, I like all your guys' shoes. It's a necklace. You know what this is? It's stuffing inside of it. That stuffing is the widow's mite. And the widow's mite would have been worth an eighth of a penny. It was the least amount of any coin that was ever manufactured. And the widow, it looks like makeup. Well, now it doesn't, does it?
Yeah.
Okay, well, it does. Okay. Can you see that? All right. And she put two of these, which would have been a fourth of a penny. Can you buy much with a penny? No, you're right. A lot of people, they see a penny on the ground, what do? They don't pick it up. They just walk on, right? Well, this is only worth an eighth of a penny. So it wasn't worth a lot. But that's all she had. And she gave because she loved the Lord, right? And she was still thankful, even though she might not have a lot of money. You don't have a penny? That's okay. You do at home. All right. I'm so thankful that you do. And that's important. But she wanted just to show her love. Because right before that, Jesus was talking to how the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they weren't very nice to the widow. But she still gave all that she had. Now, they had this thing that looked kind of like the head of a tuba. And that's what was in the box, to hold the box. And they would take their money and put it in there, and it would rattle around. And people were thinking they were giving a lot of money. But this wouldn't have made much noise, would it? No. It wouldn't. But oh, it does feel like makeup. Okay. Next time I'll just bring makeup, okay? Okay. But anyway, it's so important to remember that everything we have comes from the Lord, right? And when we do give and we do make an offering, what that means is we're just thanking God for what He has given us. And we're so thankful and so grateful. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and put this up, all right? So I can keep it. Oh, that's my phone. Okay. Well, that's my cord. All right. Ready to pray? All right. Okay. Well, dear Lord, thank you for loving us. And we thank you that all good things come from heaven above. And just help us and remind us, dear Lord, that as we give, it shows that we love you. And it also shows how we know you can use this to help others. And dear Lord, we thank you for that. So just bless these children. In Jesus' precious name. And all of God's kids say, amen. Amen. All right, you guys got it down. Thank you so much. At this time, we'll be singing You Are My All in All, and you'll find that on the screen. Please join me as I pray for our offering. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you as we receive this offering today. We ask that you would bless it, that it further your kingdom, because we know that all good things come from heaven above. And dear Lord, that people would hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Not only here in Ellsworth, but throughout the world. They'd hear the good news and Jesus' life and death and resurrection, that we serve a risen Lord that has defeated sin and death. We thank you. Not only that you're blessing this offering, but blessing each and everyone here today. Blessing those that are able to give financially. Those that are able to pray. Those that are able to serve. And for their presence. We thank you and praise you for all of this. In Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Now at this time we'll have our scripture reading. And the verse will be found in the... Oh, yeah. The other church, I don't do that. I'll get it. Not. Thank you for reminding me of the doxology. It's amazing what I can forget in 4 miles. I'm amazed. But we will have the reading of the scripture. I better check. All right, she's ready. All right. Okay.
Well, and I'll join in on the forgetting. Due to state tennis, the church office will be open Monday through Thursday and closed Friday. So, the first scripture reading is Proverbs 11:24 through 25. Some give freely, yet grow all the richer. Others withhold what is due and only suffer want. A generous person will be enriched, and one who gives water will get water. The second reading is from 1 Timothy 6:17 through 19. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty, or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Deanna. Before I pray, we've been doing the sermon series on Enough. The first week was When Dreams Become Nightmares. We were talking about affluenza and creditis, where we're trying to do all we can to keep up with the Joneses. The next week we talked about wisdom and finance, and we talked about the prodigal son, the one who wasted money. And then the following week we talked about cultivating contentment, that restless heart syndrome that is never satisfied with anything, but yet we are wired by God because only God can satisfy us. And today we'll be looking at defined by generosity. Would you please join me in prayer? Gracious God, we thank you. And I just humbly ask that you'd give me the words today, that we'd have a greater understanding of generosity, that we know that we are blessed when we're generous, because it's better to give than to receive. So minister to each one of our hearts, that we'd have interpretation, application of your word for our lives. And I ask, dear Lord, that you would hide me behind the cross so they'd see Jesus and not me. I thank you and praise you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen. You know, I was thinking this week in the video. I'm not thinking very well. I'm going to sit down, let you guys watch the video, and we won't do this for another year. Video four times, and I've got it right twice. So in baseball, that would be really good. But this is not baseball. All right. Well, I was thinking this week, in the month of June and in the first weekend of July, I had four funerals, and I had one every Saturday. And this last month, I've had three funerals, and I've only known a couple of the people. So when I had the opportunity to talk to the families, I would say, would you tell me something about them? Could you tell me their characteristics? And how do you think they wanted to be remembered by the way they live? You know, and that's something that we could say for all of us. How do we want to be remembered by the way that we live? I once had a parishioner in Protection, Kansas, that he came from McPherson, and his pastors put out on the sign, because he put it out, he was the one, he was the custodian, and he put it out. He said, live your life a way that you would want it to be lived so your pastor don't have to lie on the at your funeral. Well, he liked it anyway, but, you know, it is important. How are we living our life? How are we living our life? And as you saw the little clip about generosity, that's what we're going to talk about today. Well, first talk about theological foundation for a generous life. Because we're created to be generous, but we're tempted to hoard. We're tempted to hold back. God created us with a willingness to give to God and to others. This design is part of our makeup. Maybe that's why Drew thought that coin looked like makeup. But we are actually have the need to be generous. And it leads us, when we're generous, it leads us from not hoarding to what we have. The truth is that hoarding offers us no real security in this world, in this life. Because we cannot find our security in our stuff. We really cannot. But we hear voices. We hear the voice of fear. We fear of what might happen to us, along with the misplaced idea about the true source of our security. It keeps us from being generous and leads us to hoard on what we have. The truth is that hoarding offers no real security. The voice of self-gratification. We have the voice of fear and the voice of self-gratification. Our culture tells us that our lives consist of the abundance of our possessions and our pleasure experiences. But so we find ourselves thinking, if I give, there won't be enough left for me. If I give, there won't be enough left for me. So how do we defeat these voices of fear and the voices of self-gratification? When we give our lives to Christ, we invite Him to be our Lord of our lives. We allow the Holy Spirit to begin changing us from inside out. We find that our fears begin to dissipate. And our aim in life shifts from seeking personal pleasure to pleasing God and caring for others. Although we may wrestle with these voices of fear or self-gratification from time to time, we are able to silence them more readily and more effectively when we grow in Christ. When we grow in Christ. And the more we grow in Christ, we realize that our lives belong to Him. The more generous we come, generosity is the fruit of the Spirit. I want to share a song with you. I promise not to sing. I don't even know when to come in, but I will read these words to you. About 5 years ago, his name was Brandon Heath, and the song is Give Me Your Eyes. Look down from a broken sky, traced out by the city lights, my world from a mile high, best seat in the house tonight. Touch down on the cold black tile, hold on for all of a sudden stop. Breathe in the familiar shock of confusion and chaos. All those people going somewhere, why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the once forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. step out on a busy street, see a girl and her eyes meet, does her best to smile at me, to hide what's underneath. There's a man just to her right, black suit and a bright red tie, too ashamed to tell his wife that he's out of work. He's buying time. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? I've been there a million times, a couple of million eyes, just move and pass me by. I swear I never thought that I was wrong. Well, I want a second glance, to give me a second chance, to see the way you see the people all alone. I want us to look at biblical reasons to give to God and others. From Acts 20:35, it is more blessed to give than to receive. From Matthew 16:25, those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake, they will find it. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. From Psalm 24:1. And the biblical guidelines for giving. From the very early days of the Old Testament, God's people observed the practice of giving some portion of the best they had to God. A gift offered to God was called the first fruits or the tithe. And it equaled one-tenth of one's flock or crops or income. Abraham was the first to give a tithe or a tenth. And this is way before the law. From Genesis 14:20. And praise be to God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand. Then Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. And from Genesis 28, verses 18 through 22. Early the next morning, Jacob took the stone that he had placed under his head and set it on a pillar and poured oil on it. And he called it the place Bethel, where the city used to be called Luz. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and watch over me all this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, so that I will return safely to my father's household, then the Lord will be my God, and this stone that I have set up a pillar will be God's house, and all that you have given me, I will give you a tenth. And from Leviticus chapter 27, verses 30 through 33, a tithe of everything from the Lord, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belong to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. Whoever would redeem any of their tithe, add a fifth of it. Every tithe of the herd and flock, every tenth animal that passes under the shepherd's rod, will be holy to the Lord. No one may pick out of the good from the bad, or may make any substitution. If anyone does make a substitution, both the animal and its substitute become holy and cannot be redeemed. Giving a tithe. As Christians who live under a new covenant are not bound by the law of Moses, but we look to it as a guide. We look to it as a guide. Yet most Christians agree that the tithe is a good guidance for our lives, and that one that is pleasing to God. Though tithing can be a struggle, it is possible to virtually every income level to give a tenth. If you cannot give a tenth right away, take a step in that direction. Perhaps you can give 2% or 5% or 7%. God understands where you are and will help you make the adjustment necessary to become more generous. When I said It's virtually under every income level. There's 950 billionaires in the world. That's billionaires. But many of them are not giving 10%. They look at and say, wow, that is so much. But you know, when I look at what God has given us, one could look at it as 10 apples. And so you have 10 apples laid out, and the first one goes to God. But many times what we do, we take that one apple and we take a bite out of it because there's something that we might want or something we think we need, and then we take another bite and another bite, and before you know it, well, all you have is the core of the apple. Giving beyond the tithe. Tithing is a floor. It's not the ceiling. God calls us to grow beyond the tithe. That we should strive to set aside additional percent of our income as offerings for other things that are important to us, such as mission projects, schools, church building funds, and nonprofit organizations. What our giving means to God. How does our giving affect God? From the earliest biblical times, the primary way people worshiped God was building an altar and offering the fruit of one's labor upon it to God. See, really, offering is worshiping God. They would bring the sacrifice of an animal or grain as a way of expressing their gratitude, their devotion, their desire to honor God. The sin of the offering was said to be pleasing to God. It wasn't that God loves the smell of burnt meat or grain. Rather, God saw that people were giving a gift that was expressing love, expressing their faith, and their desire to please, and their desire to honor God. And this moved God's heart. When giving is in the Spirit, our offering blesses the Lord. What is God's response to our giving? And from Luke 6:38, the words of Jesus, "Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure pressed down, shaken together, running over. It will be poured into your lap, for with the measure you use, be measured to you." And also the parable of the bags of gold from Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and trusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2, and to the last one, 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey, and the man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put the money to work and gained 5 more bags. And so also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. "Master," he said, "you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more." His master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." The man with 2 bags of gold also came. "Master," he said, "you entrust me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more." And his master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness." Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. "Master," he said, "I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathered where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid, and I went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is the one that belongs to you. And his master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I would harvest where I have not sown, and gathered where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers, so that I, when I return, I would receive back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. What our giving means to us. Through it, our hearts are changed. When we give, our hearts are changed. When we are generous to God and to our families and friends and neighbors and others who are in need, our hearts are filled with joy. They are enlarged by the very act. When we are generous, we become more generous. From the book, Enough, it was talking about a young man. His name was Jeff Hansen. He was 15 years old. He went to the Kansas School for the Blind. He had a genetic condition, but they were able to improve his eyesight where he could read that big E on the top of the eye chart. And when he was going through treatment, the Make-A-Wish Foundation asked him what he would like. And he said he would like to meet Elton John. Well, Elton John came to Kansas City, and then he received a ticket for himself and his family to meet Elton John before the concert. And Jeff enjoyed baking and painting, and he would do these cards and do artwork, and actually he would sell them, and so he would give the money away, and he was showing his cards that he had made to Elton John. And Elton John was impressed, and he said, I also want to give this to you. And he pulled out a check to Elton John. He said, I want to give this to your foundation of the AIDS work that you're doing. And it was a $1,000 check from a 12-year-old. He was so moved, he asked if his family had any plans, and he sent them off on a vacation to hear him play at another concert because he wanted more to learn more about Jeff. But also, about a week later, the foundation called Jeff and said, we just want to let you know that Elton John was so touched that he put $5,000 into this foundation. In it, we will find the blessing of God. Many Christians have it wrong. They say, if you give, then God will give more back to you. But that is not how it works. We do not give to God so that we can get something in return. Let me say that again. We do not give to God so we can receive something in return. The amazing thing is that when we give to God and to others, the blessings just seem to come back to us, of course. There is no guarantee that if we tithe, we'll never lose our job, or we'll never have bad things happen to us. Nevertheless, when we give generously, the unmistakable blessing of God flows into our lives. You've received green papers this week, and I'll have a prayer, and then Ken will play some music, and you can bring your offering, but if you don't, not your offering, but your green form that says that how much you're going to pledge for next year. But if you don't want to do that, there is also a box in the back. Normally we have a meal, but COVID-19 has changed things, and we do have a sticker that we'd like for you to take and put on the back of your windshield our appreciation of just how generous you are. I mean, this church has been so generous. We're still doing well financially. And it's such a blessing. But I just want to thank you again. But we're receiving this pledge because it helps us figure out what our budget is going to be for next year. And I just want to thank you for your generosity. We are so blessed in this church. So you can bring that after this prayer, and then when Ken is playing, or you can put it in the box in the back, but we do have a gift for you. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Would you please pray with me? Oh God, we thank you that you have given us life, that you sustain us by the power of the Holy Spirit, and that you gave Jesus Christ as an offering for us and for our sins. We thank you for the abundance that we have in our lives, and we pray, oh Lord, that you would help us. Help us to honor you with our tithes, our offerings. Help us to care for the poor and those who are in need. Help us to recognize that it is more blessed to give than to receive. We offer ourselves to you. Guide us now as we prepare to fill out our cards. Help us, O Lord, to do your will. Lead us. We pray. In your holy name, Jesus, amen. Ken, would you please play? Gracious God, I thank you and praise you. Dear Lord, we just ask that you just bless these pledges. Dear Lord, because they're going to be used to make a difference here in Ellsworth and throughout the world. As they reveal to us our budget that we will have for next year. I thank you again for everyone's faithfulness, for their generosity. And dear Lord, they do it out of love. You have first loved us. And dear Lord, you are changing us and transforming us, and that we wouldn't listen to those voices of fear and self-contentment. So we thank you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Now today we'll be singing our last hymn. I'm going to ask you to please stand. And if you're comfortable standing. And the song is Lord, Whose Love Through Humble Service, number 581. 581. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. And dear Lord, we thank you as your Holy Spirit continually reveals to us what a blessing it is to give over receiving. I thank you again for the generosity of each and every one, continually to minister to their hearts and that they would share of your love with all. I send them out in your power, power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.